Good morning, everyone. So we're going to start today's seminar. That's at an unusual time, but we're very excited about today's speaker, Chris Mason from Cornell University, that Lynn will introduce a bit later. So today's seminar is sponsored by Pacific Biosciences, that we more commonly known as PacBio. As you probably know, PacBio has pioneered a single molecule real-time sequencing, and this approach has provided very long reads, most of the time longer than 20 kb. Which has been critical in many different applications like whole genome sequencing, targeted sequencing, and other things like RNA-seq and epigenetics. These long reads are usually very, very critical for one reason, and that is because most of the other sequencing technologies provide reads that are only a few hundred kb long. So this has been very useful to us and to many other places, including in some of the projects that Chris will present. Before we go into Chris's seminar, so we'll have a few words from Wenning Zhu, who is the PacBio sequencing sales specialist. She's also the local account manager at Pacific Biosciences, and her technological background is in molecular neurobiology, which basically proves that sequencing can be applied to pretty much everything and anything. So please help me welcoming Wenning. And she's going to give us a few words about the applications of smart sequencing. Thank you.
Thank you all to be here, and thank you IGS for inviting us to be the sponsor. We really appreciate it. Pacific Biosciences has had a really long-term business and collaborative relationship with the IGS, so we cherish that. Thank you for having me here. So just as I was introduced, I'm the local account manager. I work very closely with Luke's group. I haven't had a chance to talk to many of you. I assume you're all genomics specialists, scientists. So if you have any projects in mind, go to Luke or come to me. My email address is on the slide. So today it really is Dr. Mason's talk, and he's fantastic. He does a lot of interesting and fascinating work, so I won't take up too much time. But I do want to go over a couple of announcements and a little bit of roadmap of smart technology where the company wants to see we are going in the next couple of years. So right now, the SQL system is our current platform. As mentioned, we are able to sequence on the average 10 to 15 kb and with very high consensus accuracy. And we, among all the sequencing technologies, smart sequencing has the least amount of sequence bias. And at the same time, because there's no amplification, we are able to detect epigenetics base modification information along with base calling. So that's a very unique feature of this sequencing technology. So because of these characteristics, we are able to compare to short-read sequencing. We're able to look at fully phased, full-length, whole genome sequencing, transcriptome sequencing. We're able to discriminate pseudogene from gene from pseudogene, which is, has a very important application in clinical diagnostics. And in addition, minor variant discovery, structural variant discovery, which can be kb long, that can be resolved and discovered on this platform. So just a little bit about where the company sees ourselves going forward. So in towards the end, right now the system per smart cell, which is our sequencing chip, can produce about 5 gigabytes of data, which, you know, compared to Illumina, it's that is a technical limitation. But towards the end of this year, the goal is to be able to improve another twofold of data throughput through chemistry improvement. And another goal towards the end of last year, next year, 2018, will be another twofold, and we're hoping that this is on the roadmap by about a year and a half or 2 years, the goal is to have overall 8-fold increase on the throughput. So if you have projects in mind, this is the roadmap map going forward. So 8 times 5 gigabase, so we're looking at about 40 gigabase in a year and a half to 2 years. So, and you know, what comes along with throughput increase is really ultimately about dropping the price. So we are looking at about $1,000 whole genome, de novo genome sequence, human genome size, in about 2 years. So as of now, we have about over 300 units worldwide. Half of them are in North America. So I don't, that's, you know, as all you know, that Luke's group here at IGS, the sequencing core, has been using PacBio smart sequencing for what, how many years now? About six, seven years. So they are really the expert. I'm sure some of you have worked with him on your projects, but just keep in mind what we are working on right now. And so going forward, we're coming out with new software for minor variant discovery, structural variant discovery. So along those lines, and also multiplex microbial sequencing. So talk to Luke, talk to me, and we have a local team who can support you. So we look forward to seeing more of your projects. Another couple of announcements before I give it to Dr. Mason is we have in actually 2 weeks at pharmacy school, we have a user group meeting. It is to be held on the 27th and 28th. We'll have two workshops, one on library prep, one on bioinformatics, and one whole day of talks on different applications of smart sequencing. There will be speakers from at different universities and a couple of speakers from commercial pharmaceutical companies. So if you haven't signed up, it's right across the street. So it's we feed you, give you wine, so just come if you're free that day, those 2 days. I would say the second day, the talk, the second day, the 28th, would probably be the most relevant, or you'll learn the most. And in addition, we also have a microbial sequencing grant that's due by the end of this month. So if you do any sort of microbial sequencing, submit a 250-word, you know, application. We'll give you all the sequencing reagents, and Luke's group will do the sequencing. So any sort of interesting projects you're doing, we do it. We offer it to you for free. So the deadline is end of this month. And with that, thank you very much. Enjoy the talk, and Dr. Mason.
Well, thank you everybody for turning out on Monday. That's not a normal time. I think you're really enjoying Chris's talk. So Chris Mason started out early days in Madison, Wisconsin. Moved over to Yale, a graduate school. He's now at Weill Cornell in New York City in the School of Medicine. I work with him and Emmanuel as well. I look for Emmanuel then. We look at the metagenomes of subways around the world, doing just sort of surface sampling. But Chris is going to talk to you about a number of studies. He's quite dynamic in his group, looking at going work at NASA, doing, I think, some single cell now. And I'll talk to Sherry Stein about extreme environments that they're doing as well. They're literally looking at the most extreme environments around the world, whether they're in, you know, Antarctica, there's some sampling there this year, out in the western United States, or other places where you have lakes where the pH is just a crazy acid or crazy base. And then you have all sorts of different organisms they're looking at there. So I think it'll be a little joyous talk, and And very collaborative, so if you find something you're interested in, give me a chat. So they'll be around the rest of the day.
Great. Hope it's working. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Lynn and Manuel, for inviting me to come here. Thank you very much to Jacques also for hosting. So it's with a great bit of excitement. I'm going to tell you about all the things going on in the lab. And let's see. Looks good. So as you can tell already, I am a fan of kind of very preposterous talk titles like Inter-planetary Genomics. We will not quite be interplanetary by the end of this talk, but we will be kind of suborbital. So we're not, we won't end up on Mars, but we will get close. And the reason that I want to take you there is because I want to describe our contribution to a really long-term vision for what NASA is thinking about putting boots on Mars by the year 2035 or maybe 2033, depending on orbital mechanics. But this is their goal. They actually want to have people go to Mars and actually begin to potentially settle the planet. So unfortunately, with this artistic rendering, it appears as if Mars is sucking all of the nutrients away from Earth. That is not the plan. It is to have two planets, not just one. It's a rendering. But I'll tell you about some things we're doing to understand and expand our views of the central dogma and fundamental understandings of what happens to the body in space and think about the technologies and ways to get there. I'll start with a bit of background. So first is what happens to the body over time to begin. What really just goes on as we age? This is a slide I use often for first-year medical students at Cornell, as I just describe over time. Interesting things can happen to your cells. So for example, over time, the number of cells in peripheral blood that have lost an X chromosome, lost an entire X chromosome, increases over time. Most of the kids in the class think it's kind of funny because they're down at this part of the plot. They're not yet at the end of the plot. So they this inexorable march towards molecular oblivion, I sometimes call it, they think is kind of interesting, but I find it's less funny in older audiences, to be quite frank. But it shows that things change over time. It actually, this dysregulation at the genetic scale and even epigenetic scale, which I'll talk about, happens as a consequence of time. Of course, telomeres shrink over time. These shoelaces at the ends of your chromosomes also snip off over time and shrink. And one of the questions we think in the lab is, we look at also in the clinical context, we look a lot at cancer evolution. And this is from a review paper where we talked a lot about what goes wrong over time. How do mutations emerge and molecular insults become anchored into the genome or the epigenome? And really, genetics has been studied for a long time, but really one of the big questions in the lab is, what else? What else changes, not only over time, but also in the case of disease and pathogenesis? And so, obviously, there's, of course, the epigenome, with a sort of beautiful regulatory layer behind DNA and the central dogma. And it's not just one mark, of course. There's actually a slide, a variation of this was originally put together by Jonas Korlek, who's the CTO of PacBio, actually, was looking at variations of all the epigenetic marks that you can see here in red, which give you this sort of color to the genome and give you this ability to regulate when and how and where things are expressed and turned on. So here's the epigenome in red. And really, the fundamental question, we have a group in the lab that just says, how do you go from four atoms to a phenotype? How do you have a simple methyl group, which you can draw in a lot of different ways, to create and manifest as a phenotype of gene expression or a change in your body or in your cells? And this is actually a very old modification, first discovered in 1925, so it is really, really old, actually. And it was originally positioned as this idea of a metaphor. And so at some point, biology needs some metaphors, or at least I feel like I like to use them. And it was first discovered that, why don't you put this into a metaphor of a landscape? Is that you start out as a pluripotent cell. All of you in this room start out as one cell. If you didn't, please come see me after the lecture. I'd like to talk to you. But all of you should have started out as one cell as an embryo, and you had the capacity, this totipotent and pluripotent cells eventually, that let them differentiate into lineages that all become all the cell types in your body, which you can see here in the bottom some examples. And this lineage specification that proceeds in an orderly state is really exciting because it lets you sort of end at the bottom of the well, and eventually you can go back to this top of this well of potential when you become an embryo again. But these epigenetic marks in DNA methylation are so uniquely defining different tissues that they've actually recently been used by our lab as well as others to start to look at actually monitoring where cell-free DNA is even coming from the body because these epigenetic marks have been maintained. So this is one example of, in the last 6-7 months, a lot of papers have come out about revealing the tissue of origin. So you might even in the future know approximately where cancer came from and what the mutations are in cell-free DNA, but just treat those mutations and know only vaguely where the cancer came from and not even be able to see it on something like an MRI. So this is being discussed a lot at Cornell. But so it's really exciting that we can live in this time of actually measuring what I call the epigenome dynamic. They change over time, they change as a consequence of disease. But I want to jump back to the beginning of when things really got started. So how do they change? And when we think about going to, say, Mars, what can we expect to see? So we'll start back on day one. So when egg and sperm came together, essentially you can see here, this is, you may remember this, or actually you probably don't because you were an embryo, but If you could remember it, there was, you know, there might have been some Marvin Gaye, there might have been some Candles. I don't know what happened with your genesis, but that's my fantasy of mine. Is a sperm and egg came together, and this is an antibody for methylcytosine, so you can see here in green, and blue is Daphne staining. So you can see when egg and sperm come together, this is a beautiful paper from 2000, that the paternal genome on top actually gets rapidly demethylated first. So you have this, you know, resetting of all the epigenetic marks happening first to the paternal genome. Eventually you become two cells and then four cells, and you more passively reset a lot of the maternal marks. But you have to reset all of the epigenetic marks back to zero to enable that totipotency of all the cells. As you can see, it was followed up about a decade later, looking again at what's the percent methylation across the genome. In general, most of the human genome is very methylated. Eventually it comes back near zero in the inner cell mass and then spikes back up as you start to specify the different tissues in your body. And so if we think about identical twins, which I'm going to come back to at the end, when you're born, at first, if you just take a methylation-specific enzyme and you cut across the genome for very specific spots, you can see, near birth, they're almost the same. But over time, epigenetically, they also drift. There's this consistent drift that happens over time, just as a consequence of age and cell types changing. So you can see here in identical twins, they change. But what's interesting is this had been known for a few decades, but it took about 3 years ago, Steve Horvath, he said, well, see, there's definitely a pattern here. Let's download every single publicly available data set. Some people call them research parasites if you work for the NEJM. But let's download every publicly available data set that has age and methylation and just see if it's a pattern. Is there any kind of trend? Let's say, for example, when all of you leave DNA behind in these chairs, could I come back through after this lecture and sequence the DNA you left behind, which we didn't get approval for, but we talked about this, but maybe we could do it next year. We can see how old you are, we can see maybe what you've been doing, and particularly it's because of this pattern. Steve Horvath pulled out essentially 353 marks that can very specifically tell you approximately how old you are, plus or minus a few years. But it's because there are these certain marks across the genome that age like an epigenetic clock ticking over time. You can see here the training data set, the validation data set. It's a little bit more dynamic when you're younger, but all of you are leaving DNA behind that could inform how old you are. So if you didn't want to show me your license, it doesn't matter. I'll just follow you around and sequence your DNA, and I could do it that way. I don't know why I would even be asking for your license, but I'll come back to that point later as well. But interesting trends and what changes over time. The other thing is, this is also a little bit, it's been critiqued a bit in literature because it also, the proportion of types of cells in your bloodstream also change over time. So it's a little bit confounded. But nonetheless, it's been replicated by ourselves and other groups. And what's really great about this is you can see induced pluripotent stem cells, when you reset the epigenetic marks, they actually become almost a negative age, actually, you know, minus years. It's not as if they're sucking time away from an adjacent cell. It's just a linear model is what you can see down here, for example. So, and then embryonic stem cells go back near zero. And, you know, essentially this gives you a way to reveal your age. And so with this as a backdrop, we've actually published in the past few years a number of algorithms and tool sets to look at DNA methylation and epigenetic data. One is called MethylKit. There's other tools called EDMR. We originally had the name for this in the lab, MethLab, as our toolkit, but then we thought that would be a poor choice for an algorithm name, so we did not stick with that name. We now call it EpiSuite, and I want to tell you a brief few vignettes this morning in the clinical genomics lab, then switch to microbial and then to space genetics. And so on the clinical genomics, I'm going to talk a lot about the clonality algorithm we just recently published. And so and what this was built off was actually reading one paper a few years ago from Landon, which is one of these papers that once you read it, you can never unthink this idea. There's a few of these papers I feel like in my career I've read, and this is one of them for sure, is that it's a simple concept in epigenetics, that on average, each one of these areas is the same. On average, methylation 25% methylated. But clearly the pattern, or what they call here epipolymorphism, is very different depending on what you look at. So they linked this at one point to changes in gene expression regulation, and noted this polymorphism eventually was linked potentially to risk for cancer. So we wanted to use this idea, so actually if you grind up a bunch of cells and smush them down and you sequence the DNA, assuming your cells are diploid, which is an assumption for cancer, but assuming they are, they serve as a molecular built-in barcode of the phased epigenetic marks that came when you ground up all the cells. So actually if you stack up all the reads, you could actually, even if you just have on one read four adjacent CpGs, you can actually then use it as a tracer for what is actually that cell origin and the proportions of those cells. So we called these epialleles and then started to build colors. And actually want to see a diagnosis and relapse in the first set of leukemia patients. Does it change? And indeed it did. We could see a diagnosis versus relapse. We could see these large clonal shifts, epigenetic clonal shifts, that we're wondering are the same as the genetic or not, so we weren't sure at first. But first we needed some terminology, so we called these eloci and defined the number of eloci that are evolved per million loci sequence, so you have a normalization for coverage. And then when you don't know what to do with the data set, of course what you do in lab is you make a circles plot, because you immediately feel better. It doesn't matter if you've learned anything, but you feel great right away. You have a circle spot. In this case, it was mildly informative, but in this case, we had six patients, which are rings on the inside, the human chromosomes on the outside. The black marks are places that were epigenetically evolved, and actually under selective constraint to actually evolve. epigenetically. And so this was one of our first data sets we looked at. We want to see, though, you know, does this actually, you know, harken back to this Horvath idea of things changing and evolving, but, you know, what do we see in cancer if we look at more patients? In this case, what we just published a few months ago is this look at genetic versus epigenetic evolution to really look at the question of what comes first, what's more important, which, how do they change vis-a-vis to each other. So in this case, this is a summary of the work. We look at the question, do you have separate paths for epigenomes or genomes in their evolution? And a lot of this was driven by one cancer patient that we had five time points. So in particular, this was a patient who we did serial whole genome bisulfide sequencing and whole genome sequencing and deep sequencing to see at five time points what changes first. So this is the EPM metric, or the epi alleles that are evolving versus the number of somatic mutations on the right, to see how the two trajectories panned out. And we could actually see that the epigenetic evolution seemed to occur faster and actually first before some of the epigenetic changes. So if you look at each time point, there were, of course, some somatic mutations built in, but they didn't change it much until later in the tumor. And so at least in this index patient that inspired the study, he's actually a guy who cleaned the tanks at Chernobyl and developed leukemia afterward, really gave us a window into what seems to be happening, that epigenetic evolution might be happening first and potentially in an independent capacity. Then we, going back to the previous study, thought, well, does this change gene expression? We did look at the variants of gene expression with single-cell RNA sequencing in both, and we saw in both cases you have a lot more variants of those loci that are changing. But then we wanted to look at a larger cohort of patients and say, well, you know, that's interesting, but actually does it separate out any group of patients of high or low risk? And so in particular, with this as a model, when you see these selection for different loci, different cells that have epigenetic marks, then they get selected. You know, if you see in blue, you know, this sort of clone take over, we could actually see for patients, you know, across all patients, but then more importantly, there was a set of intermediate risk category. We didn't know whether high, low risk, had no idea. Even for those patients, we could separate out the high and low risk with a sort of an entirely new biomarker, a new measure of the tumor's complexity and how it's evolving. So in this context, we described that it seems in these patients, only 140 patients, but there are really, you know, three groups of patients, some where there was both genetic and epigenetic evolution, and some where there was only one or the other that seemed to be separating out. And that those, this metric gave us a way to separate the risk of those patients. So it was a very interesting sort of data set. But upon finishing the paper, I was talking with one of the clinicians, and we're talking about next steps, and she said, you know, Chris, this paper's been really nice, but all you've really done here, you know, all you computational people and you genomicists, you just like to find biomarkers, but all you really do is separate out bad patients from really bad patients. So that doesn't actually help anyone clinically, not that much. And so she said, well, what else could we do? And so in the last 6 months, we've been going in two different directions to think about better ways to utilize this information. So in particular, one is to just get better granularity and resolution. So on the C1 system on Script Hub, you can download some tools actually for doing single-cell RBS, and also they already have one from the Greenleaf Lab on single-cell ATAC-seq, so you can actually do single-cell epigenetic resolution. It's not fairly automated on the C1. But I think more interestingly personally is that actually we, everyone's doing CRISPR these days. We want to think about CRISPR systems as well to modify some of these sites. And everyone's doing CRISPR, your high school students are doing CRISPR, my grandma's doing CRISPR, everyone's doing CRISPR, right? But now that we're doing epigenetic at CRISPR as well, the same idea applies there. You can actually, if you want to actually have a guide RNA that targets a specific loci, if you attach a DNA methyltransferase, in this case, TET1 and see which actually can pull away methyl groups, you could actually use this system to have a hybrid fusion protein go in and specifically target an epigenetically change very specific loci. This is with Don Wang Fu's lab at Sloan Kettering. And here we can see from some of our first guide RNAs that we're getting in some targets that actually are working. So you can see with the triple knockout, almost everything is methylated in this mouse model, but we're starting to get specific guide RNAs that are pulling down the methylation groups at very specific loci you can see here. So this is very early data and very new, but it's actually exciting because the vision that we're hoping for is that eventually you would be monitoring genetically and epigenetically any cancer and actually reprogram and adapt to the different targets that you would reprogram in the patient as therapy is ongoing. So this is something we've just started. So I think the second thing about being very responsive and adaptive to cancer as it inevitably evolves. And so, very neat data.
So can I pounce on that first? An ongoing enigma is methylation a product of expression? Like, is it the result of a gene being turned on, or does it change a gene being turned on? And here what you're saying is, oh, we should be able to change the methylation pattern and, I think, induce a change in the expression. So what's going on there?
So
have you thought about it?
Yeah, great. So we the different paper that I'm not talking about today, but we even DNA methylation gets a little bit of a bad rap, actually kind of appropriately, because people say, well, the correlation is kind of crappy, right? So you get an R squared of 0.4, like it's kind of actually technically minus 0.4. It'll often be inversely correlated. The more you methylate something, the decrease in expression on average. But you also have many cases where it's the exact opposite. And we published about a year and a half ago is that hydroxymethacitazine is probably a better marker, and also, but it's further away. It's using enhancers that gives you a better gauge as to the change in gene expression. And there it's positively correlated. So if you increase hydroxymethacitazine, you'll increase gene expression in the inverse. So I think the story is still new. I think it does change. It's currently strongly associated with the change in gene expression. And in some cases we've seen here in cell culture, it does change the gene expression, or at least increases the variance. But it's very heterogeneous. So our obsession with single cell sequencing is because there's all this heterogeneity that we've never been able to really resolve until now. And single cell is not perfect because you also have technical artifacts that I'll get into shortly. But I think the story is that it's not just going to be methylcytosine, it's going to be hydroxymethyl, plus, of course, open and closed chromatin and other histone modifications. But I'm a methylation guy. I think histones are just disgusting. They're proteins, they're gross. I just don't look at them that much.
I was worried because you went for four slides without saying a joke. So
I do comedy shows as well. Sometimes, right? But some of it's serious. Some of it, I'll come back to it. But so I want to switch gears to transcriptome as well. We do a lot of work in the lab on RNA sequencing, which gets to your question of expression. So I'm going to come back to that. In particular, RNA sequencing, if any of you grew up in the array days, at least as I did, I got really tired of arrays and got really excited when sequencing began to be applied actually to RNA. So RNA sequencing, at one point long ago, I said it's the same thing as love, and I'll tell you why. Because it used to be with an array, you would just get gene expression data, and you would get a little bit of information, usually at the 3' end. But with sequencing, I got very excited back in 2007, 2008, is because you can start to sequence something, but compare it to many different references and get a lot of information that's per-base information, per-base resolution, and look at lots of questions at the same time. So in particular, you can look at genetic variation. It's a sequence-based assay, after all, so genetic variation. You can look at gene expression by gene, exon, isoform, allele, and transcript. You can look at, say, non-coding RNAs or new genes that haven't been seen before, which we're hunting for right now, in a variety of contexts. You can look at gene fusions. You can see poly-A binding site changes or microRNA binding site changes and how these all alter. And then whatever's left over, in theory, could be something that was growing in your cells. Could be Epstein Barr virus sometimes we see hanging around. So whatever's left over. So this is all from one experiment, which is very kind of exciting. We worked a lot, and like 4 or 5 years ago with the FDA to make this sequencing quality control consortium, which you can pronounce SEQC or sexy. That was done on purpose. So if you're working at your computer, people will come by and say, "What are you working on?" Say, "I'm working on something very sexy right now," and they'll leave you alone because it's a sexy science project. But really, it was a very dorky science project. It was how do we get best practices and rigorous testing of each of the at that time existing sequencing platforms and publish this all together as a big consortium. All the tools, scripts, and code are publicly available, and this was done with NIST, so you can go here and download everything. But we did this because the field was nascent, and people were doing different things, different platforms, different chemistries, different aligners, everything was kind of up in the air. And so it was to normalize some of that to get clinical grade RNA sequencing was the goal, but also was to address a really old question in human genetics. So you remember like the simplest question, how many genes are there in the human genome, right? It's a really fairly straightforward question. But the initial estimates, actually we were talking about John Quackenbush on the way in here, that maybe there's 120,000 genes because we must be more complicated than a C. elegans, a worm. We've got to have more than like 30,000 genes, right? We're humans, look at us, we must be more complicated. This is some of the original estimates. But then, over time it came down, it's come back up. But then if you look at where we are today, the current official estimate from the GenCode, which is the best annotated, probably curated set of human genes, it's about 20,000 coding genes. There's more non-coding genes than coding genes in the human genome, so don't forget about them. And it's about 60,000 genes total. So there's actually a lot of genes today to look at. So my favorite thing though about this number is not the number itself, but sort of the trajectory of it over time. So this is what's happened to the number of genes in the past basically about 7 years. As you can see, when I started the lab and at the end of 2009, you can see we had about 50,000 genes, but it's better today. We've got like almost 60,000 genes, which is pretty fantastic, I think. A lot of it's been driven, you can see, by a long non-coding RNA discovery over time. And you might see something funky in this plot. You see you lost about 1,600 genes about a couple years ago. You may have been in the shower, you may have been doing your shampoo, and suddenly felt pain in your chest and said, "Did I just lose 1,600 genes?" It was just a database merger of MERBase and GenCode. That's all that was. It must have been bad food. But what's exciting about this trajectory is that we'll eventually have, I think, about 100,000 genes by the time we get to Mars, because we'll probably need them all when we get onto this planet. But, okay, to get back to something serious, is one of the goals of the SEQC study was this simple question of, okay, we sequence deeper and deeper and deeper, the same sampling. And then this is one we did up to 12 billion reads. And an old nagging question, which is coming up a lot in metagenomics and microbiome work as well, once now we're doing shotgun, is if you keep sequencing, where is the end? And this depends a little bit on which reference you use, GenCode or HP or RepSeq, gene annotation, of course, matters. But when we sequence deeper, we never saw a perfect plateau. And it begs this question of when we see 5 reads out of 10 billion sequence reads, what does that mean? How many cells was that expressing? Was it just transcriptional noise? Was it just a drunken RNA polymerase that was running around the cell? What was that that represented? And it was really born out of frustration because we couldn't yet at the time get down into single cell levels. But today, actually, the fourth part of the talk play is we very much can. So old papers that spent $100,000 in years to get single cell data is just replaced by today, which is now over a dozen different options. I just reviewed them recently in this paper, all these different single cell sequencing methods from a variety of different providers. So today you don't have to ask the question of did something respond at a single cell level. You can say exactly which proportion of cells and measure it with any number of these options. So what we've been using a lot recently is the 10x and the C1 system, and I'll present a little bit of data here, is that when we look at the question of response to therapy, for example. So this is a patient treated with the cytobine. We wanted to compare, essentially before and after therapy, what happens to the cells. And each one of these dots is a different cell. There's a Tisney plot, which is a dimensionality reduction plot, and you can see in red the normal cells on the lower right. The responding patients, actually their cells are floating as a cloud of gene expression towards the normal hematopoietic stem cell state, whereas the non-responders actually shifted more up to the left and actually away from some of the untreated patients as well. So it shows you that it's not a question of did you respond yes or no, but now we can pull out each individual cell that did respond and look at the expression why. You can also look by patient. If you color by patient, you can see it's not being driven all by one patient, for example. And they are clustering a little bit by patient still, but you can actually see them moving by types as well. And when we look at the individual cells and then color them instead by what genes or types of gene expression there are, so you can start to make these colored plots of what's the expression, say, of HSC signature genes or stem cell genes versus myeloid signature genes. You can see that separates out again the responders and non-responders as well. Another way to analyze these data is to view them as a lineage, so like a lineage trajectory. We actually want to put them into what's called pseudotime. There's a variety of tools that you can use for this, but there's a monocle or wanderlust are the tools. In this case, we can separate out normal cells and what the fraction of cells that exist on different lineage dates. So you want to try and order the cells as if they're being going through development, much like embryogenesis. And so this is a tool where you can start to separate out the proportions of signature states in treated versus untreated and responding patients. And we found this interesting branch at the lower right that really defines some of the non-responders, and we can actually then pull out those genes. You can see basically here post-treatment non-responders really enrich for some of these cell states. And when we look at what those are, it represents a lot of DNA damage, as well as you can see transcriptional manipulation of cancer, some of those genes that separate the high and low pseudotime. I know pseudotime sounds like it's kind of fake time and fake data, but it's not. It's just a way to order things, time of lineage progression. So this is what we've been seeing with single cell data. But so this has actually been published a lot by other groups of finding new subsets of cells and pseudotime. But one of my favorite things actually about this data recently is that we can now ask a question that's also been nagging me for a long time is, how can you look at all the isoforms in individual cells? Until recently, it was actually very hard or almost impossible to do so. But to look at this really simple question. So say you have one exon, you can make one thing, assuming there's no alternative 5' or 3' splicing sites. But if you have two exons, you can make 3 variants, and that's 1 splice junction. 3 exons, 7 variants, 3 splice junctions. This increases at a pretty normal combinatorial rate of 2 to the n minus 1. So how many isoforms can your genome actually make, and how many splice junctions do you make? It increases at this rate. If you think about all the genes in the human genome, that actually means that there's more possible splicing combinations in your body than there are atoms in the universe, because it's mostly hydrogen, helium, it's a relatively boring place. And so it's really this extraordinary complexity is possible, but of course you don't make all those isoforms because you literally cannot make them all. But so at some point cells have to decide which isoforms can and will we decide to use at different points in individual cells. And what I'm excited about is we've now been able to, we just published a tool on our lab's website called Disco to analyze this kind of data. And we can start to make plots of what proportions of cells are using different isoforms. And here you can see for patients that have spliceosome mutations here in blue, that they will shift up here for the second isoform, which you can see here in the middle. And the proportion of cells expressing that isoform shifts up or shifts down. And there's bulk RNA sequencing data here on the right. So you can actually, really for the first time, start to separate out what proportions of cells have which isoform. What this means yet, we are just discovering this. We don't sure if it is a clinically relevant, is it just interesting phenomenology? We don't know yet, but it's interesting that we can finally ask that question if we have a clinical one. So jumping back to the center dogma, the fifth part would be a little bit on the epitranscriptome, which is sitting in the middle here in the regulatory layer of the center dogma. Made up word, didn't exist 5 years ago. There are some people who call it RNA modification, some people call it RNA epigenetics, which would just be a collection of terms. Today is called the epitranscriptome, and was recently reviewed in Nature's that the RNA code is coming into focus of what happens to the RNA as well. The idea is about the same as you have a methyl group, and you want to say what happens to the RNA means to tweak that RNA. The most common one you'll probably think of is 7-methylguanosine, but there's many, many other kinds of RNA modifications. Chuan, he's done great work in this field, and there's a whole slew of RNA modifications. There's even a bunch of guys up in Albany who just sit around and think about types of RNA modifications. They make a database, you can go to the database. We decided to look at one called methyl-6-adenosine. It's one of 112 known RNA modifications, so it's not just a handful. There's a lot of them, when I say dorky, I mean it in the most positive way possible, by the way. The dorky guys are the best guys. So we did a review of this a few years ago to say, well, how often do they occur? They're across all spans. All organisms tend to have some variations of modified RNAs, and actually many types of RNAs show these kinds of modified states. So it's not something a peculiar state of RNA. It's actually very ubiquitous and kind of a defining feature of life, at least on this planet. But the question of what they're doing is a longer version of this talk, but effectively the metaphor today is that it's a lot like what you do for DNA methylation. So if you want to change your cytosine, your DNA methylation, you rotate between methyl hydroxymethylformone, carboxyl cytosine, and you change the states. What we've seen, at least from the discoveries published to date, actually there was a new one last week, is that there's all these enzymes that do the same basically kind of chemistry. You rotate the types of RNA depending on what you need them to do, where you need them to go, and how long you need them to be stable, plus what you need them to be translated for. So it affects translation speed as well. We did also a summary of this here. So if you go back to the central dogma now, it looks a lot more like this, I'd say. So it's a lot more messy, but I would say more beautiful because it has all these complex layers of, say, RNA binding proteins or reverse transcriptases, or there's even evidence of viral-induced microRNAs that can persist between generations in C. elegans. And, you know, prions might make you kind of creeped out because they're kind of disturbing and they're creepy. Maybe you don't want to eat beef anymore. But there's other areas of the central dogma that has self-replicating information. Ribozymes, DNA transposons also copy themselves. So it still means prions are creepy. They're just less subtle and alone in their creepiness, I guess I'd say. So also, no one uses the word epiproteome. It's in PubMed twice. No one uses that term because everyone just says post-translational modifications. And in principle, you could say post-transcriptional modifications, but this generally epitranscriptome, it describes all the modifications and they're studied in general. But it's a semantic point at this point, but I think I like the newer central dogma. So that's where I'm going to close on the human side. And human cells, they're all wonderful. You all have lots of human cells. You all have 10 trillion human cells or so. Some of you more, some of you less. I'm not here to judge. You all look beautiful today. But, that's the human side. But we got to think about what's beyond the genome, right? That's the human genome. Of course, the simplest and most obvious example is when you go outside, you will sometimes get bit by a mosquito. And, of course, this is a nice cross-kingdom interaction that happens just walking outside. And this obsession with RNA modifications and DNA modifications led us a little while back to start doing pilot work on, well, what about RNA viruses? And actually, for about the last 5 years, anyone I met who worked on any RNA, they'd be having a conversation and say, well, do you think RNA is methylated? And the answer is always no, because it's such a nascent field. So that's what we should just start looking. So in this case, we looked with Stacey Horner as a collaborator at Duke, and we said, well, actually, what about Zika, for example? Is it methylated? These are the spikes of RNA methylation after you do an RNA IP. You can see here that Zika showed methylation. You saw it also for dengue. You can see spikes of RNA methylation at very specific loci, West Nile virus, yellow fever as well, and actually just published at the end of last year, a catalog of all the flaviviruses, sort of the cytosolic replicating viruses, that they, literally all of them have these spikes of RNA methylation. You can see spike up in red and converge on the NS5 gene at the end of most of the flaviviruses. So there seems to be a central conservation of this RNA modification, which changes how fast it gets in and out of the cells. So there's a really new lever of regulation that was really heretofore unknown in all of the RNA viruses. And we've also looked in HIV, looked in influenza. Literally every RNA we've looked at for any RNA virus has a modified RNA states that change whether in the cell or out of the cell and how fast they move. So that's a very also nascent part of the work in the lab. And that's on the virus side. But of course, outside of the virus, most of you in this audience, I think, have done a lot of work on the Human Microbiome Project. This is from the seminal work on the Human Microbiome Project. And every part of your body has this small ecosystem that gives you this little niche that is, essentially your miniature walking ecosystem. Again, some of you more, some of you less. You're all beautiful. This led to a lot of consortia, the International Human Microbiome Consortia. There is a lot of papers that looked at diet-induced obesity changes. You can look at how, when you eat food, how it gets processed by your microbiome. There's even a lot of links to inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn's disease. At this point, there have been over a dozen different human diseases linked to the microbiome in some capacity. So some made obvious sense. For example, you could look at eczema, you could look at ulcers. That's obvious, Helicobacter pylori. But you think of other things like depression or even autism, there's not tens of millions of dollars from the NIMH, mental health institutes, looking at more the connection between the vagus nerve and other sort of gut-brain axis questions. So this is a really exciting time, both in microbiome space and in human disease, because suddenly we have potentially a new regulatory lever we can understand disease with. And so this has led to really, I think, a lot of excitement in many fields. But it's also been interesting because you learn a lot about what is happening in your body. So you probably know this, most of you, but so many organisms work on your behalf. One of my favorite papers is from Michael Fischbach and Mohamed Dania, who's a member of MedSub, which I'll talk about shortly. But you know, this was actually, they just mined the HMP data and said, well, do these, you know, can we look for new biosynthetic gene clusters, or BGCs, that are present in this data? And can we see, maybe they're making new drugs that we just discover from the raw data itself? It's a drug discovery mechanism. Here they found something called lactosylin, which then they validated in culture and showed that it would actually work as an antibiotic that's made by normal vaginal flora that's just present in normal HMP individuals. That, you know, in one of their press releases, they said this kind of looked like something coming out of pharma. If you're a chemist, that's laughable, but it's, you know, it is close enough in the sense that functionally it worked as an antibiotic. So basically, without you asking them to do so, you basically have these normal flora that are giving you a protective vaginal microbiome force field without you even asking anything, which is not a technical medical term. It's just kind of a cool idea that you could be protected by the flora. Really, they're making chemical factories that keep you safe, essentially. So that's one example, sort of getting almost superpowers from your microbiome. But you could also imagine other places where you can get a transplant and get sort of the benefits of someone else's ecosystem. The most notable one is FMTs, which I think most people have probably heard of by this point. But if you haven't for some reason heard of FMT, they're exactly what they sound like. They transplant a fecal microbiome. They have led to really, I think, unfortunate titled headlines like this one from, for example, Scientific American. I just think of the mental image there. There's also websites that have popped up. You know, people have said, well, this is amazing. I've heard about this thing. I've heard about someone had C. diff, they got a transplant, and they got healthy. And people started actually doing it themselves. If you haven't been to this website, it's a real website. It's called thepowerofpoop.com, which I couldn't make up if I tried. Here, people go and share stories, methods, materials that people started sending each other their own medicine because there wasn't actually really a rigorous clinical trial system set up yet. And this led to Eric Alm making Open Biome and a lot of other people just diving in deeper to help me and have patients get more access to these kind of treatments. They can get them at Cornell, I'm sure you can get them here as well now. But 4 or 5 years ago, it was actually kind of a wild west, but whereas now it's actually becoming very much standard of care. And so far, actually, one really good thing is that it's been regulated more as a tissue and not a drug. And after what I just told you, of course, when you do a transplant, it is both a tissue and a drug. It's a tissue that makes drugs, processes drugs. And so it's much easier to regulate that into sort of a tissue donation instead of a drug. And so this is kind of one of the really exciting things. With a 95% success rate, you can oftentimes treat C. diff infections. And so, I mean, what's exciting is almost nothing in medicine has a 95% success rate, but this actually does also for ulcerative colitis. So it's a pretty exciting thing. Not something we work on, but just internally, but what else should you be excited about the microbiome for? That's my excitement list. But now I want to switch gears to the sad list of the microbiome, the thing that get people upset at night or at the daytime. So in particular, you'll see people in the New York City subway who are terrified just to touch the steel railings, petrified of touching any real surface. This is what I caught a woman once on the subway with a paper towel that I would argue is probably potentially more disgusting than the steel railing. I don't know, it's definitely used. I don't know where it's been, what's happened to it, right? But she's just terrified to touch. And it actually has, you know, the aperture on the holes of the paper towel are much larger than the bacteria anyway, so it's probably not even doing her any good. But she feels the need to protect herself. You've caught someone once wearing a lab glove, basically afraid to touch the steel railings. Again, this is normal on the commute. I go to lab every day in the subway. And I just thought, you know, it's really, people are just afraid. You say the word bacteria, people immediately think of bad things, negative things. They don't think about superpowers. They don't think about health. They think about disease almost immediately, which leads to behaviors like this. Some people have very particular ways to write this up, but they do kind of the butt method where they only touch with something else in their body, or they do the lean method. Everyone has their own technique. But I was always curious about the microbiome in general. All these papers had been coming out after the lab got started, and I was thinking about it a lot. And you know, I really became curious about microbiome in a discrete and sort of acute way for two reasons. Is that one, every time you sequence a human genome or any genome, when you map all the reads back to that genome, you always get leftover reads that represent the bacteria or whatever was in that organism. And the second reason, you know, I always wanted to know what they were doing there. And I thought, if I'm really a systems biologist, am I really a systems biologist if I'm just looking at human genomes? No, of course. Even if you look at all the omes, you're not really a systems biologist. You're just a systems biologist on one species. But you know, if you really look at all the species. And the second thing that happened to me, it made me curious more about the microbiome, is I just became a father. So this is my daughter when she was having ice cream, which she still loves excessively. But when she got old enough actually to ride the subway, she would grab it. Sometimes she would lick the subway pole, she would drop food, put it right in her mouth. You know, just I couldn't help but wonder, man, what is on the pole? What's there? And it's, you know, ridden by 5.5 million people every day in New York City alone. What's there? Who knows? So of course, you're a dopey scientist, you go back home, you look on PubMed, look on Google Scholar. There'd only been two papers ever published. One was about the air microbiome in Hong Kong and one in New York City by Norman Pace. Not a single manuscript really, except one about Portugal's bus poles, but nothing about New York City's surface. Almost no data on what's on the surfaces touched by millions of people every day. And I just got curious. I was like, well, what if we did? I started dropping my daughter off at daycare, and I got the daycare finished. Like, what if I drop her off? I could swab her mouth, and at the end of the day, I'd pick her up and swab her mouth again. I could see what changed, because I watched her basically drop toys, and then put them in her mouth, and drop toy, and the other kid would grab it. And all the kids were making out with each other through the toy proxy, basically. And I'm like, what is happening? And my daughter's microbiome, I just want to know. But there was no knowledge. So in the absence of knowledge, the best thing to do is to experiment, to explore, or to build what New Yorker called the metropolome. We wanted to look across the entire New York City and see what was there. So this is work that we published a couple years ago now, and I'll talk about how we built off that in the last half of the talk here. Is, you know, this was a first snapshot of New York City, which we sent students out to the city, and so we did a 3-minute swap, which is the optimal amount of time to get enough DNA, and also balance the amount of social discomfort that inevitably occurs. But then we had an app that did GPS and timestamp and did photo documentation, and also a sequence of about 10.2 billion sequence reads, confirmed with metaflan and megablast and surfing to see what was there. And one of my favorite statistics still today is that the amount of DNA that matched known species was only about half. So about 48% across all the data didn't match to any known species, which is, you know, it's full of mystery. We don't know who they are. They just are yet as unknown, but we touch them every day. Most of it was bacteria, and we had 656 species we identified with all three pipelines. We made 656 supplemental HTML5 files, so you can zoom in and out of the city and see what was found in different areas. Worked also with the Wall Street Journal to see what you could make plots of what you see for different bacteria around the city. But I wonder where the kimchi bacteria are really localized in New York City. You now have a way to do so. And this is originally called the Pathomap study. And we found, again, about over 600 species. I'd ride the subway with you. Most of them are harmless. Any of the things that look like they could be harmless, we followed up extensively since, and they are either missing the virulence markers, or if any of them are present for any species, they're extraordinarily low. And some of them only sound dangerous. For example, Aerocarpus viridans could kill you, but only if you're a lobster, right? So if you're not a lobster, then you shouldn't be worried. Or other things that, again, seem to be dangerous often lack all the pathogenicity markers or are completely absent. So one good thing about shotgun data is you can look at where the reads map to which genes and also plasmids as well. So this was the first snapshot. One of my favorite other vignettes from the study was we put these density maps across the city, but one subway station really stood out. And this is when we saw a lot of Pseudoaltomonas and other unique species we didn't see anywhere else. So what's going on there? This was the station flooded by Hurricane Sandy. You can see here these 10 species not seen anywhere else. And if you remember Hurricane Sandy back in 2012, this was actually a satellite imagery. It kind of literally took out, you know, heat parts of the coast. You guys probably all got hit pretty hard here. The NHGRI website was down that day. It was so hard they shut down the server, so really it was a pretty big storm. Came through that huge wave in New York One. You could see at some point it looked as if entire, you know, streets, or that's not true, this is from the day after tomorrow. It wasn't that bad. But it felt like that, I'm gonna tell you. So in particular, the subway actually got, this is the official map from the subway, is they shut down most of the trains in the bottom part of Manhattan. There was just so much flooding, a lot of the channels that were going under the water. And one in particular was South Ferry Station. Was this station, this is what it looked like that day. Basically, the train did not go uptown that day. It was just submerged in cold ocean water. So we worked with the MTA to get early access to the station, to actually swab the station to see what was left over, and started seeing a lot of species like Shewanella and all the marine-related species. And one particular was Shewanella frigimarina, first discovered near the Antarctic, was when it also can make something called eicosapentaenoic acid, or EPA. And so, again, you're writing a paper, you're thinking about what are these interesting organisms, what are they making? This is one that's normally found actually when you're eating fish. And it actually makes, this organism can make something, this EPA, if you have low levels of this in your diet, you can be at a higher risk for suicide. So this is kind of a positive story. Like, actually, if my daughter, you know, did lick that subway pool, if this was there, it's actually kind of positive. So it's not that a bad thing. So one time a reporter asked me, well, Dr. Mason, you know, should we lick a subway pool? Is it okay? And I gave a really long answer. Well, licking is different from touching. You know, the mucous membrane is, you know, protective barrier. It's not really recommended, but, you know, in general, most things are inert or not relevant for human health, or even some are positive. So, you know, if it happened, you know, you'd probably be fine, but still not necessarily recommended. Of course, what appears the next morning is this headline. So I stand by that because it's still technically true. You're on odds and on writ large, you will likely probably be fine. Just a warning for the media is that they will quote down to two words of what you said, because I did technically have that in my sentence. So, but right after our paper came out, I was excited because this idea of the hygiene hypothesis had really started to generate a lot more new data. In this case in particular, it turns out the worst thing to do if you start to have a peanut allergy is to take away all peanuts. It's actually better to have low-level exposure to antigens to train the immune system. As we all probably know, as most of you know, the hygiene hypothesis, you need to have that exposure to actually train your immune system, especially in early life. And so, again, it doesn't mean that subway poles are necessarily the best, but it means that, you know, to really live in a, as I think as most of you know, a completely sterile world is actually worse for you, even if you're starting to become allergic, actually. They want to keep low-level exposure more than anything else. So this leads to the question that there's all these things we can discover, and a lot of this leads towards new methods and new algorithms. And you know, there's a lot of ways you can sequence things. We actually just heard about earlier at PacBio, you know, we started sequencing in many other cities, but we looked at other methods. This was a review paper we looked at in the world kind of bifurcates in either optical methods or electrical methods for sequencing these days. And this is older now. As soon as you make a paper about sequencing, it's immediately out of date. Here I was making fun of Oxford a little bit because I said values are estimates for companies that have not yet released actual data. That was a little jab at them because they had announced in 2012 it was going to come and then nothing happened. So, but now I'll tell you this new data is actually out. It's actually pretty exciting. But as you've already heard about with PacBio, you can actually do direct detection of methylation. This is still, I think, one of the coolest things in the technology, is the ability to eavesdrop on one polymerase can let you watch the kinetic information to discern the state of the template strand and whether it has modified base or not. So this ability to watch an enzyme in real time is, you know, a lot of the IP for the company, also one of the coolest parts of the technology. And actually, we worked with Jonas Korolek and others a few years ago to say, well, can we do the same thing? This is a DNA polymerase. What if you could put a reverse transcriptase at the bottom of a small well and watch it work in real time? So this was an assay we developed with PacBio, was to see, let's do essentially, you know, watch cDNA synthesis happen as it occurs. This is the protocol for it. And you can see here, you take a DNA primer on the RNA template, and then you can watch cDNA synthesis happen and these pulses of light. And actually, you can see how it looks like that RT is stuttering a little bit, which is actually how the DNA polymerase was decades ago, or 12 years ago, and eventually got trained to be much more recessive. In this case, the RT is very early, but you can see it actually, these pulses of light match the expected complementary strand for the cDNA. This is kind of the real-time trace of it you can see here, and this is the movie trace of how it looks. And we then actually put in a modified RNA, see, can we look at these modified RNAs, for example? Here we can see it separated out the interpulsation you can see here, and it actually was, you know, what we published a few years ago is actually was the difference between the unmodified and modified template. So this is the first demonstration of detecting modified RNAs in a single molecule capacity. And, you know, it was statistically significant and there was a separation of them, but it was very labor intensive and it, you know, took a while to get that much data, but we thought, you know, it would be great if there was a way to just do this more high throughput. So we thought, well, there were rumors of this other technology, Oxford Nanopore, coming out, which they then called the MinION. They prefer you say that. You cannot say Minion, by the way. They prefer MinION, even though someone in marketing completely missed the fact that it spells out Minion. The snub you, though, if you say Minion, or Gridion, or Promethion. So there's all these new technologies. One of the older ones was the exonuclear sequencing, where you cut off one base at a time and watch it fall through the pore and measure the current that way. What ended up being commercialized was strand sequencing, where you use a helicase and pull through strands of DNA as they walk, you know, in a nanopore. And this is the principle that as it moves through the pore, you get this current trace. It's kind of similar to the kinetic data in PacBio, but now it's electrical current. And it ends up looking like this kind of squiggle space, which is an H5 file as well. In early days, they talked about being able to do basically modified RNA detection. You can see here in March 2015, they released this. There was a preprint posted last fall that showed that it was maybe possible. And then in this paper, they talked about looking at modified states of RNA, like in methyl 6 adenosine, you can see there. But what's exciting is this was still proof of principle until very recently. So actually, they're just now releasing direct RNA kits where you can actually do this. Again, something we've been talking about here at this point for years. And I'm very excited that we just posted on Twitter, which is now a presidential platform, by the way, some of the first data that we got from direct RNA sequencing. You can see here about 87% sequence identity. This, in this case, to a Syndus virus. And my favorite thing about this data set, it's very new data, it's literally just coming out of the lab last week, is that this is the first time I've seen a FASTQ file that had URSL on it. So I'm, as a dorky bioinformatician genomics guy, I was very excited just to see this. This alone made me happy, even though the data was still pretty noisy. It's the first iteration of the base caller. So that's on the RNA side. And we're trying to take, we're in the middle of taking this kind of data, this electrical current data, and applying a variety of machine learning methods to call out the modified bases. So what we've trained it on so far is methyl 6 adenosine and DNA. So this is a variety of different machine learning methods that we've used. So far, the random forest method is performing one of the best, better than neural networks. And this is, if you have a modified adenosine or an unmodified adenosine, and this, we just released this, it's an open source algorithm called mColor for modified color for epigenetics on nanopores and now for RNA as well. And so far, with the additional training on the random forest, we've gotten out of about 94% accuracy if you have about 15x coverage, and if you have one single molecule, you can get 80% accuracy for calling modified bases on one strand, which is just, it's very early days. So this is for methyl 6 adenosine, but I'm still very excited that it's working pretty well. Methyl cytosine is harder to call on nanopores. It's a little bit, you know, some things are easier than others. Actually, M6A is very easy to call on PacBio, and hydroxyl cytosine is harder. Different platforms have different abilities to call modified bases. So we're in the middle of testing this out now, but so far this is posted in our preprint, and you can look at it online, and it's actually not so bad for a rock plot. So as a quick social commentary sidebar, if you think about nanopore devices sequencing epigenetic base, and you think about epigenetic age, you think of that means actually we could just take a nanopore sequencer and go to every seat here and tell how old you are. Or you could imagine a future, you remember when you were like a kid and you needed to get a fake ID, it was very hard to get a fake ID. You had to have an older cousin or a sibling to get it. Today, though, you can just go to yoids.com and get a fake ID for any state you want. Yes, you can pay by Bitcoin. And you could imagine a future, though, where you go to a bar, maybe, and someone would say, well, are you old enough to be in this bar? Well, let's just do some nanopore sequencing compared to your epigenetic marks, and maybe it will get harder to sneak into bars in the future, potentially. That's the end of my social commentary. Okay, so as we do these things, though, here's the big challenge. Talk about changing how you get into bars, changing how you measure cancer epigenetic, changing bacterial epigenetic base calling. To do this, actually to know what's real, you'll need standards. So we do a lot of work in standard development because when you start to have new technology, new methods, new antibodies, all of them necessitate an ability to know, to really benchmark them in particular. And we don't just want to do this, you know, this is working, of course, with the FDA and in Europe, also GSC more recently, and NIST. And we don't just want to do this because, you know, we're lonely, for example. So some people think that, you know, are you tired? You want to work on your own? Do you want to see people and eat point with a stick and impress your colleagues? Some people consider meetings the practical alternative to work. We do not subscribe to this philosophy because this is a really bad thing to do. It's a waste of everyone's time. You actually want to make things that are, you know, not just loneliness avoidance, but these are things that you can order. These are algorithms you can download. These are things you can use in your lab to make sure that you have some sanity about what you're seeing, particularly with new methods, new algorithms, new technologies, and new physical substrates. And this has led also to the next version of the SCQC study, which is doing a lot of DNA benchmarking. So the sexy two, you could say we're bringing sexy back, but I think it's taken by JT. So in any case, what we're doing though is benchmarking on all these platforms, each of the human genome samples plus semi-coli standards, looking for all these base modifications, and again, comparing across all these platforms. A few of them has also been sequenced on Earth and in space, and I'll come to that in the last few minutes. But these are part of the standard development, and also they'll all be released, if you see a plus sign, the sequencing's been completed, so all these will be released this summer. So if you've been beating your head against any kind of epigenetics question or whole genome sequencing question, these that will all be coming online very shortly, or most of them are already sequenced. And so this links not only to the human genetics and epigenetic standards, but also there's now also a metagenomics and microbiome standards alliance also within this. We're trying to take some of the same rigorous benchmarking and applying it to bacterial controls. This includes the ATCC control. They have a 20-species mixture of control, basically control samples that you can put in for spiking through your sequencing assays, both in whole cell extract or genomic DNA. And what's interesting about their controls is when they've done different variable regions of 16S primers, a lot of you probably use 16S primers, you can get completely different ratios of what you see for these controls depending on which primers you've used. And if you're in the literature, probably not surprised by this, but I was struck by how dramatically different it can be, especially for even for the control. They have one control, and also Zymobiomics is doing control of 8 bacteria and two yeast, you can see here, which we've also sequenced and see pretty good proportionality. So, the reason I bring all this up is because when we start to go to new places, to go very far out, we will need these controls to make sure that we're measuring things correctly. So in particular, think about back to the original study in the New York City subway, if half the world around us is unknown, we'll need new technologies and new methods to start to sequence the rest of it. But this is not the first time that we've been in this situation. If you think back when Magellan set sail on Columbus, half the world around them was unknown. They were missing half of it. Of course, eventually we discovered a lot of it. When the microscope was first invented, a lot of the world was unknown, but eventually we found a lot more of it. And then, you know, this leads to a way to just discover the world around you. And I would argue that sequencers today are really molecular microscopes that let us see the world around us in a way we've never been able to see before. So this led to an expansion of the New York City study, now what is a global consortium, which I'm very honored to have Lynn and Emmanuel contribute immensely to the project, actually. And we have three overarching goals across the world, which is to build these metagenomic and also potentially forensic maps that you can trace who's going to different places and when and where. This is by the Gates Foundation. They're really interested in this because we're tracking antimicrobial and antibiotic resistance markers, both by genetics and epigenetic marks. And you can also use these data to find new BGCs. You can actually mine the data, as Mohamed Dahi is doing, to look for potentially new drugs, new molecules. So in particular, some of the ones already that have come up from the data in New York City is that these different areas across the city are predicted to make these different biosynthetic gene clusters, which you can see colored here. So this is ongoing work in the Dahi lab to validate them. But it's not just in New York City, but this is our little our fun movie of what happens actually once a year. As when the world wakes up, you can start to see just past the, mostly on the west part of the world, you can start to see, the east part of the world, people wake up, start to collect samples. And as the Earth turns, we see these little bubbles pop up and get bigger as more and more people wake up and collect samples, what's called Global City Sampling Day, which is to build up this broader and larger map of the metagenomics of the urban areas that we all share. And the website, you can actually go to each little spot on the city and see what's been collected and at what time point. And you can see this was Global Sampling Day last year. We're getting approaching. Actually, in 9 days, we'll have the next, the second annual Global Sampling Day is coming up very soon. And all the data and the methods and techniques are all shared and publicly accessible. Even the correspondence on the Google group is publicly accessible, which some people were surprised at one point. But it's all very transparent and open. And this was originally part of the Nashville Microbiome Initiative. I do not know the fate of this in the new administration. We'll just have to wait and see, I think, on that one. And it's also funded partly by the Gates Foundation. And so as we track all these things around the Earth, there's going to be some inevitably some question of, okay, if we see something weird like on the space station, is it really alien or is it not? We have to, the only way we would know that is if we sequenced everything on planet Earth. And if you had sequenced every single organism on planet Earth, it would immediately be different 20 minutes later because species evolved. But let's say we get close to that. We could say we start sequencing things on the space station, or we start sending people to Mars, you know, in the long, long term. To do this, we need to have a better catalog and understanding of what just happens into the body at all levels. So this has led to one of the big projects in the lab called the NASA Twin Study, which you look at identical twin astronauts, and you can see here there's a little patch. I'm very excited. We did manage to get the little epigenetic marks here on the patch. It was part of the discussion with the artist. And this is not just my lab, there's 10 labs total collaborating on this, many of them here. And we wanted to really build, like, what happens to the body in space and have a complete molecular portrait. So this involves collections, essentially looking at genetic variation, hydroxymethylation, DNA methylation, RNA expression, RNA methylation, proteomic changes, chromatin, antibody titers, B cells, T cells, telomere cytokines, target global metabolomics, microbiome, cognition, vasculature. Not just to do this at one time point, but to build the systems biology portrait. And we did this 6 months pre-flight, then 12 months on the space station, and then 6 months upon return back to Earth to kind of get a catalog of what's happened. And it's included 19 time points and 3 vaccinations. So what we've seen so far from the data that's been released is that there are some hints of the stress of space travel. So some of the things that were reported is that he got both taller and younger. And this is technically true because there was a lack of compression in the spinal column, although it went away as soon as he landed. And the younger is because he was moving closer towards the speed of light. And so you might be thinking, well, how much was it? Was it like an interstellar where, you know, Matthew McConaughey lost 50 years? It was not like that. You just can put in the Einstein's time dilation equation, you can see that, you know, assuming an orbital velocity of 7 kilometers per second, about 400 kilometers up, you can see it was only over the course of a year about 0.1 second difference. And he was already six minutes younger than his brother, so he's really just a little bit younger than his brother who was on Earth. The other thing that we actually worked with NASA a lot was to get new methods for getting blood samples drawn in space and also extraction. So this is astronaut Koichi Wakata, his protocol for the blood sampling. You can see here, this is the challenge of drawing your own blood in zero gravity, is that you actually, the tubes don't stay put, right? So what's amazing about the astronauts is they often have an empty stomach and they're doing this first thing in the morning and often alone, you know, drawing their own blood and tubes floating around. Also, they don't just do it once. But you can see that up on the right, dangling is sometimes 9 or 10 or 12 different tubes that will get CPT tubes or EDTA tubes to draw blood from the samples. And so some of them were frozen and some were also dropped back, put in through the atmosphere and then sent back to Earth. And then they were landed back in Kazakhstan. You can see here the retro boosters when it lands, that's how it lands in Kazakhstan. Brought back, repatriated, I've never used that verb until the study, repatriated back to Houston. And these are actually cells that were just in orbit only 36 hours prior. Sometimes it takes longer to get to a meeting than to get samples from space. In this case, we could actually see that the cells actually over 90% viability look pretty good. And one of the things that we've seen so far, work with Susan Bailey and others in the consortium, is that if you look 60 days before flight versus mid-flight, you can see the telomeres did indeed get longer. This is across all the cells. This is using a frequency, the number of cells, and the relative fluorescent intensity of the telomeres. And you can see they also got shorter, though. So really, the middle of the distribution got pushed down. You got some cells that were very close to dying, and other cells that, on average, telomeres got longer. And then we actually wanted to see, well, how does this compare to Mark, who was on Earth, and also use qPCR and FISH again. As you can see, Mark Kelly stayed about flat, Scott went up, and then went up in a different method. You can see here, we validated this on 11 other astronauts. We saw the same trends. Those are being written up now, it'll come out later this year. It does seem to be a pretty distinct change. I thought, well, we've got all this other data. Does it show up elsewhere? And we can see changes in DNA methylation. You can see decrease in DNA methylation in a few spots across the TERT gene. And we can also see changes in expression levels during flight, and then we'll go back to normal post-flight and pre-flight for telomerase and telomerase-related genes we've seen. So it seems to be a real result and a really peculiar result. So it doesn't mean you're gonna live forever. There are some cons. You do have bone loss, you do have a lot of cortisol spikes, you are being irradiated heavily. So there's some other cons to being in space, but it does seem as though at a telomere level, you will be technically slightly younger. And so it's not quite the fun of you, but it's interesting. So on the last part of the work with NASA, though, is to think, well, we had to bring all these samples back. What if we get to a state, though, where we can just actually do sequencing in space? Could we actually do it in space? And this is work with Aaron Burton and others at NASA to do the BSeq mission. And of course, what you need, NASA just immediately gives you a patch whenever you start a project, which is always very fun. As we're planning this mission, we're sending up some resupply mission samples for the twin study, and one of the samples blew up on the way to the space station, which was a very sad day. But one really striking thing about this explosion was I got this really touching letter from NASA, and also Scott Kelly tweeting, space is hard. And they said, you know, encourage you and urge you to continue your inquiry and meet adversity and keep going. I was very touched, because if you get a cut by the MAH, you don't get a letter or really even an email, and it just shows up sometimes in the system. So it was very, you're telling us to keep going was very touching. And at one of the twins called, we were discussing this explosion, and then Andy Feinberg said, hey, I'm going up on the parabolic flight simulator with the Vomit Comet. Does anyone have any experiments to do? I said, well, actually, yeah, we've been planning this mission for the sequencing in space. How about we send you a minute and we should try it? And he said, yeah, send it over. Well, first, let's see if we can do some pipetting in space. And I said, yeah, okay, we'll send it over to you. So this is Andy Feinberg getting ready to do, as the parabolic flight simulator goes into zero G, you can see things will start to switch over in zero G. Makes it hard to keep track of your pipette tips. You can see why we didn't use pipette boxes. We used those bags of tips and we did the mission. And as the parabolic flight keeps going, you can see things just start floating around. And eventually you'll get to the bottom of the parabola, so you have to then get to the bag, grab the end. So Andy's a great sport about it. He did manage to get going, him and Lindsay Rosario actually got the MinION loaded. We did see that, you know, it worked. We got some reads in zero gravity, which we could confirm based on the current actually as well. Like they shifted up higher. Here's the picoamp current differences versus the hidden Markov model base and also the ground control. You can see it shifted up. But basically what we're doing is matching waveforms to other waveforms. And where else can you do this if you think about it? It's actually in Shazam. If you're at a loud bar and you want to hear a song that's on, you can actually pull up your phone and match it. So we published an algorithm called the Uncovering Fingerprints of Genomes algorithm, and it's actually made into a grant that got funded by the NIH of like having Shazam in the grant. I was very excited that they didn't laugh it out of the room. But the idea is actually you convert them to waveforms instead of converting to base space, which you can do here. And this was is now published in Nature Microgravity. You might be thinking, is there really a journal called Nature Microgravity? Yes, there is. It's right here. It's a very new journal. And it's actually, you can see these spots are in 0G versus 1.8G. You can see the current change during the mission. So, okay, so going back, we're planning to go up. I want to sequence space. Kay Rubin's the one who was perfectly timed to go up. She's a trained virologist and got to go up into space earlier last year. Made her way up there no problem. Then we sent the resupply mission last summer. The return booster came back fine. And then basically this is Dr. Rubin for the first time getting the flow cells ready, holding them up in 0G, getting ready to do some sequencing in space. Loaded things on, and then we started to get reads. It was kind of a eureka moment, just that it worked at all. We're very excited. Not only did it work, and so this was kind of the first time sequencing in space occurred with Dr. Rubin's, but it was called sort of the dawn of genomics in space. And we did it multiple runs, now 9 runs, and actually got over a billion bases sequenced. And so far, the accuracy on the old flow cells is about par for the course for the version 7 flow cells. That, you know, you're showing accuracy about 89 to 90%, or the 1D reads are less, but, you know, instead of reading both complement and template strain, just read one strand, the 1D reads. But these are better these days, but there was actually, we saw that it was on average 1 or 2% better in space than on Earth. All the data looked better. So it seems like, so far, one of the conclusions, we should just do all of our genomics in space, except for the $10,000 per kilogram cost to get it up there, a small cost. But then we took these reads and actually did a de novo assembly and compared it to PacBio, which is still the gold standard for genome assembly. And then we could see we got pretty good de novo assembly via coli and actually really good confirmation from PacBio. So this represents sort of the first genome sequence and assembled off Earth. It's posted on Bioarchive, and it's also in review right now in a more formal journal. So coming back to the very beginning of the question, I think when you think about where are we going, you start sending people to far away. Now, to Mars, for example, we can think about health as well as disease, not just precision medicine, but even predictive medicine. Can we see what's in the environment before you get there and even respond with what antibiotics you send to space or even to a different city before you go on vacation? Can we get more predictive about our medicine? Is one of the big goals in the lab, not just to be precise about it, but it also look over the head. And this is also now NASA's official poster for their mission. And as you can see here, they've got DNA methylation, I'm very excited, and RNA methylation is on their NASA poster. I'm very excited that made it there of this guy who's floating and apparently disintegrating on his way towards Mars. In conclusion, cancer and even life evolves at all these layers, genetic, epigenetic, and epitranscriptomic. RNA modifications are really pervasive, and I think creates this new epigenome and epitranscriptome regulatory axis, which we're studying a lot on. There's also our measures for clonal evolution give you a new prognostic relevance for patients, which has not been seen before. Space is hard, things explode. And we need more controls, one thing I really crave. We start looking at identical twins with this idea of an N of one study being powerful. To do that, you need many, many more and more controls, especially epigenetic controls. And we can now sequence in space. It's now officially a part of the space station as hardware. So if you want to think of projects and send them up there, you can now actually do so, and you can have very remote diagnostics. So at the end, I want to thank everyone in the lab who makes all this possible, of course, and wouldn't be able to stand here if they weren't so awesome. And of course, I want to thank Mark and Scott Kelly for giving blood, sweat, and tears. This is their official NASA poster for their mission. You can see here they snuck in the Death Star in the background. And of course, thanks from the NHGRI, NIH, Bailey Foundation, Sloan, and World Quant Foundation. Thank all our collaborators, the Book and Bioreactor, we're sequencing at West Cornell and MIT Media Lab. And of course, everyone in the lab and collaborators, thank you also, Lynn Emanuel, and happy taking questions. Thank you. I won't tell any more jokes. All my bad jokes in one talk. Like in which cells?
Yeah,
actually in B cells we see it was not as long as we saw in T cells. So we see we have T cells, B cells, CD4, CD8, CD19 separated cells, plus lymphocyte depleted fraction in both PBMCs. And there is some cell type specificity. So it seems it's not just across all cells, like it's magic panacea. So which it links to. We see also changes in the adaptive and immune response as well, so I think it's linked to that. But we're writing all this up now.
So regarding the RNA modification, are these modifications seen in every cell, and do they lead to any changes in the protein that's actually produced?
Yes. So we've seen them. I think in every tissue we've looked at, we have seen some brain tissue. Cell culture, we've seen them in primary tissues, we've seen them in primate tissues. Every single tissue we've looked at does seem to have a differential amount of this RNA methylation. It's confounded with the fact that RNAs by themselves are very volatile and very dynamic. So I think, is there one tissue? What we've seen so far is brain tissue seems to have the most.
I guess my point is, I can understand how it could lead to maybe different DNA stability, maybe different RNA stability, but does it also contribute to a modification does it result in a different protein rather than what you see if you sequence the DNA?
Great question. So it does not, as far as we know, the protein stays the same, it's just the speed with which it gets made. It's not like RNA editing where you can actually convert deaminated adenosine to get inosine and it gets read differently as a new kind of protein product. So, and oftentimes people studying epitranscriptomics will blend in RNA modifications and RNA editing into the same conference because they're very related topics. You have ADARs or other enzymes or APOBEX coming in, like binding the RNA and modifying them. So in the case of just methyl 6 adenine or 2-primyl methyl, some of the other modifications, they do not seem to alter the protein final product as far as we know. And just the speed is also easy.
So they didn't get younger, they get less old.
Yeah, we should say, the headline, you should never trust a headline for any science paper. It's generally one of the morals of the story, but they're just, because it's a relative time frame, right? So there's no one older or younger, they're also different relative time frames, so as a scientist I would say. So they're just different. It's kind of like all of you, none of you are better or worse, you're all just different, you're all wonderful, different in your own relative frames. That's not true, there's a test afterward that you're going to be ranked. but it is relatively stupid.
So you mentioned the sequence there as you've got more bivalent space, and did it actually change in significant ways?
Yes, it did. So Fred Turek is leading up that section of the study, the gut microbiome study. So we collected the vacuum pump tube in the space station. So none of you should take for granted that you have a very large bathroom and you don't have to prep it for 30 minutes before you use it, by the way. The gut collections were, they did change, but they also had a different diet. We tried to get Scott to maintain the same diet as Mark, basically. And so it's easy for Scott, he's regulated, he's in space, and everything gets sort of rehydrated. Mark agreed to keep a food log and a food sort of a record, but it included things when we looked at it, things like nachos and margaritas. It's not having that space. So it's confounded by the diet difference. But there's been enough studies on mouse models that we know that even if you keep the diet the same on Earth in space, you still see differences. And so that we're comparing, we're trying to separate out what is the diet cofactor versus Earth. And so there's other additional astronauts that are also being tested, so we'll have a good sense of that, not just those two, but we have 11 other astronauts we're using as a context for what else changes. But that is a compound. So they do change. The bacteroides in one of the bigger categories that changes what we've seen.
One thing that was interesting, that there's been some papers on simulation, like space simulation on Earth. where people share space.
Yes.
And there was not, I mean, at least the result of the smallest study, there was no real like homogenization of their microbiota over time. So do people in real space, do they share microbes? Is it more likely than on Earth?
So this is a discussion with NASA, because we have access to all the twins data, but we don't by default. You apply for one mission at a time and one product at a time, so we're trying to open up all the databases. We have other samples with Venkat, who's at JPL, to sequence the environment, and we're trying to see, was there something that was in the space station that looks to be a new species, maybe a new bacillus, that then we see it actually get on the skin of Scott, for example. What is the transfer rate? So a lot of the answers we don't know, and Kate Rubin just talked about this at ASM a couple weeks ago. So there's little pockets of studies, but there's been nothing really systematic that's been done in the space station. But we do see, I actually think some of the previous studies that have been done, if there were 16S, they might not have been granular enough to actually tell you whether or not there was a transfer, or mobile elements could have transferred. They definitely get each other sick as soon as they get up there. If someone has a cold, they all get the cold, but that's not surprising. They're in a big aluminum tube.
I have a question about the subway microbiome. So for that one, if you look at the dominant genus, did you compare that to HMP microbiome, whether the subway one is more similar to a skin microbiome or something?
Great question. Yeah, that's actually figure 2B. So yes, it looks just like skin. I usually have it in the talk, but for China, I obviously covered way too many things, so I took out that slide. But we saw that also sort of Curtis Huttenauer, he did the Boston subway, same thing, but the surfaces look like skin, which is not too surprising if you consider, of course, it's touching it. So the most enriched category from HMP species was skin. There also is a category in the HMP test that's called the heart microbiome, and I recently got an argument with a reviewer for a paper. So there's another thing as a heart microbiome. Part of the official HMP data set on their website. So it's a few species that are also heart associated, but there's only two of them, just a quick sidebar. But it's there on the website. But skin, short answer is yes. Mostly staph epi, that's a lot of actinobacter, but mostly skin epidermal type of species.
Second question related to that, because in your pie chart you said like almost like half of the read does not align to any microbes. Mm-hmm. So I just curious, because you mentioned when you identify the genus, using metafly, right? So when you remove the host, did you remove all the eukaryotic genome, or could that be underlined? That could be fish or animal, whatever.
Yeah, good question. So we kept in one of the other in the other figure in the paper, we looked at the human DNA and then predicted ancestry from whatever reads did map to ancestry informed markers. It's a freely available tool called Ancestry Mapper, and then compared that to U.S. Census data, so we could see if the neighborhood was Black or Asian or Hispanic. With a very, in many cases, almost perfect correlation with the neighborhood, so we could predict what neighborhood you're in based on the human DNA left behind. So that was actually another analysis of the paper, which we're now looking to see in all the other cities around the world. How reproducible is this result across different cities? Some cities might be more homogenous, some might not be less, we don't know yet. But in New York City, we could tell very discreetly which neighborhood you were in based on the census data, and then the human alleles that map around on top of that. So that was one of the figures in the paper. And then plant, we also looked at some. There are some other things there. We looked at plant. There was one sample that had a huge spike of cucumber and chickpea DNA, which we think is a falafel, but we don't, you know. When you start to get, there's more mysteries in that paper. If you read the paper, like, we describe a little bit of what's background from the blast results, and then we quickly just switched to the human genome and the other well-defined bacterial species, because there's actually, it was just New York City recently put this as billboards. They have these hashtag NYC fact. And if you take any read that can map with at least 75% identity across at least 70% length, which for blasts is pretty loose, but even if you do that, you still get half of them that don't map at all. But if you do that, there's potentially 15,152 species that match from the data set. So it's like a small number we kind of put in there and said, but you know, it's blasts and it's pretty lenient, so we're not going to talk about it too much. But now it's considered an NYC fact, and so the city started putting billboards that said there are 15,152 life forms on the subway. And then people will post in the comment section, that's totally gross. And so people, but I think it's totally interesting. But the biggest problem is the databases. They're mostly incomplete. So we see matches to plant, we see sometimes chickpea, cucumber, we see things that pop up. But my confidence in almost all of those maps are, you know, is low and will get better over the next 10 years, I think. But the databases are woefully incomplete to say, you know, was it really a hedgehog? Was it really a badger? Was it, you know, a squirrel? You know, some things might make sense, but. I don't talk about it here, but we have recently been doing people's cell phones at conferences, and we can see if someone has had, say, a pork sandwich, we can see if someone's had an orange or a banana, we can see that on your phone, actually. So there are some if it's a well-defined genome that's well-assembled, you can actually use it, but genomes themselves have human contaminants in them, they have bacterial contaminants. I mean, if you do enough genome assembly, you would end up not trusting most of it, but we can talk about that for a long time. But you should trust some of it, I guess. I don't want to think you're not trusting anything. But, Well, thank you.